गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन, कैन यू ऑल हियर मी? थैंक
यस सर,
यू।
यस सर।
ओके, सो वील कंटिन्यू फ्रॉम बैंड थियोरी दैट वी डिड लास्ट टाइम। वी वर ट्राइंग टू प्रूव द ब्लॉक्स थियोरम यूजिंग अ डिफरेंट मेथड, एंड वन ऑफ द इक्वेशन दैट वी हैव अराइव्ड एट लास्ट टाइम वॉज द फॉलोइंग। लेट मी जस्ट राइट दैट। By the way, can somebody tell me, did we start the chronic penny model, or did I just say that we will do this?
No, sir.
We have not done, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, okay. Thank you. Let me just write this, and I'll explain again what this is. C k minus k dash equal to zero. Okay. Now what we had done was we had taken an ansatz for the psi, okay, or ansatz in the sense we have taken a Fourier transform. Remember, the psi is a function in real space. We had taken a Fourier transform of this, and we had written this as cq e to the power I q dot r, okay, and then we said that we will apply periodic boundary conditions on this, which gave us conditions on q. And what are we investigating here? We are investigating a particular kind of a Hamiltonian, which is translationally invariant on the lattice. Okay, it's periodic on the lattice, and this is periodic because the potential is periodic. Okay, so that is the main idea. And no matter what the form of the potential is, okay, the potential could be, for example, something like this. It could be something like this, okay, it could be something like this, doesn't matter, okay, whichever the form is, this particular Bloch's theorem always applies, okay. And the Bloch's theorem, the form that we had derived earlier using the translation operator, was that psi of r plus capital R is e to the power I k dot r psi of r, okay. So, but using this equation that we derived, now how did we derive this? We started from the Fourier transform of the psi. Then we also did a Fourier transform of the U. Okay, the U is the periodic potential. So we took the periodic potential and we did a Fourier transform of that also. And the Fourier transform of the periodic potential turns out to be in the reciprocal space in this form. Okay, notice the difference between this k and this q. Okay, this k is a reciprocal lattice vector and is not within the first Brillouin zone. It actually takes you from one unit cell to the other unit cell in the reciprocal space. Okay, whereas this q is within the first Brillouin zone. So it is a vector within the first Brillouin zone, and it's almost like a continuum. Whereas this sum over k is a discrete sum. Okay, so that's the main difference. Now, what we had then done was we took this psi, we took this u of r, and then substituted this in this equation. Okay, and when we substituted into this equation, this e here is this e. Okay, so when we substituted this equation, then we got another set of equations for the coefficients c, right? And that is this equation. And if we solve this system of equations, then we will get the coefficients c, and because we will get the coefficients c, we can then get the wave function psi of r. Okay, so that's the main idea. So now, given this, we showed that psi of r is basically sum over k dash C of, sorry, this is sum over k, C of k minus capital K e to the power I k minus capital K dot r. Okay, so we showed this, right? We proved. And what this means is that if I now do psi of r plus a translation in real space, then you can see that this coefficient is not going to get affected. It's only this part which is going to get affected. Okay, so let's see what comes out of this. We get C of k minus capital K e to the power I k minus capital K dot R plus capital R. Okay. So this gives us two things. One is this remains as it is, and this part becomes I K minus capital K dot R, and then multiplied with e to the power I K minus capital K dot capital R. Okay. So now let me ask Unnimaya, are you online?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So can you look at this part, the second part, okay? And then tell me, how can I simplify this? Are you able to see the cursor?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. So in this part, is there any simplification possible? So there are two parts, right? E to the power I small k dot capital R, and there is a e to the power I capital K dot capital R. Okay. So do you understand the distinction between the small k and the capital K?
No, sir. I could not attend previous classes. So
okay. Okay. Yeah. So when I was telling you the distinction between the small q, the q here, and the capital K, could you understand that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Q is within the first Brillouin zone.
Correct. So the small k is also in the first Brillouin zone, but the capital K is a reciprocal lattice vector. Okay. So if I take the dot product of a reciprocal lattice vector and a real space lattice vector, what do I get? What is capital K dot capital R? Do you remember?
It's an integer.
It's an integer. Is it just an integer, or is there something else to it? It's actually 2 pi times an integer.
Yeah.
Okay. And if I take e to the power 2 m pi I, what happens?
It's a zero.
No,
it's sorry, one.
Yeah. One, right. So which means that in this whole thing, only e to the power I k small k dot capital R will remain. The other part will become one.
Yes.
Right. Yeah. And this summation here, this summation, I have written it incorrectly. This is actually capital K. Please excuse me. This is also capital K. Now this e to the power I small k dot capital R will remain. Right.
Yes,
but
yeah,
that is not being summed over. Correct. The summing over is only over the capital
K. Yeah.
So this will
come out. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. You can mute yourself.
Thank you, sir.
So this is e to the power I k dot R times sum over k C k minus capital K e to the power I k minus capital K dot R. But you notice that this is the original wave function psi of R, right? So this can be written as e to the power I k dot R, okay, times psi of R. So this is the first form of the Bloch's theorem that we had derived using the translation operator. Okay, so this particular wave function satisfies this property also, that when you translate it by a certain lattice vector, it picks up a phase factor. Okay, but it also gives us another form. So notice, starting from here, we will derive one more thing. Okay, so let's take this as let's write this whole thing as e to the power I k dot cap small r, okay, times a small k c k minus capital K e to the power minus I k dot r. Okay, now let me ask Ashish, are you online?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So Ashish, can you tell me any specific property of this second part here? Is there a special property of this? Is there like some kind of a periodicity or some other thing for this particular part? If I write this as some UK of R, okay? So this UK of R is this second part, right? Sum over K, C K minus capital K e to the power minus I K dot R. Okay. Do you think this UK of R is periodic in the real space, or is it periodic in the K space, or anything like that?
I think, sir, it will be periodic in real space.
Okay. Can you show that? How will you show that? Your answer is correct.
Yes, yes, sir.
How will you show that?
If we again, sir, translate it with the capital R, then
correct.
We'll get the same UKR.
First, if you translate it with capital R, correct. So UK of R plus capital R will basically give you again UK of R. Right? And that's because you will get an extra phase factor, which is K dot capital R. And K dot capital R is 2 pi times the integer. And that will give you 1. Okay? So this is now the other form of the Bloch's theorem. So thanks, Ashish, you can mute yourself.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. So this part tells you that the Bloch wave function can be decomposed into two parts, one which is just a plane wave. Okay. And this plane wave is reminiscent of the free electron in free space. Right. So if we had a free electron in free space, then this would be the wave function. However, because the electron is inside the crystal lattice, which has a periodic potential, this plane wave gets modulated. And this modulation has a periodic part. Okay, it has a periodic form. So this is a modulated plane wave function, and this modulation is periodic in the crystal. Okay, so that's the essence of the Bloch's theorem. Let me just write this once again. Yeah.
So there was a factor e to the power I small k dot r.
Huh, that's correct.
So if we are translating it by psi r plus capital R,
huh,
so what will happen to small k dot r?
I'll tell you, yeah. So this is what we got. And the UK of R was basically sum over k minus capital K e to the power minus I k dot r. You agree with this part, right? This statement is okay, right?
Yeah.
Hmm. And this is true for Hamiltonians, which are periodic in the real space. So essentially what we are saying is, if you have any Hamiltonian, which is periodic in real space with this period R, right? Then you will have eigenfunctions of this form. That is the main statement, okay? So now, Krishna, your statement was that this is e to the power I k dot r is there, and this will spoil the periodicity, correct? What is the question?
No, my question is that if we are saying that psi is periodic with capital R.
Huh. No, psi is not. Sorry. It's only the UK. That's the whole point. So I'm saying that if I had taken free space, okay, the eigenfunction would have been just e to the power I k dot r. You agree? If there was no periodic potential. Okay?
Yeah.
But if we have a periodic potential, then the statement is that the eigenfunction will be a modulated plane wave. That is the statement. And it's not that the wave function is periodic, it's only this part which is periodic. The modulation is periodic. The plane wave part is not. Okay? Fine? Yeah.
Sorry, I think I heard incorrectly. Yeah.
Okay. That's not a problem. Okay, so this is the essence of the Bloch's theorem. Now, there is something interesting which is not usually dealt with in textbooks, but I thought I'll mention this because this is something at the very forefront these days. Okay? And that is called Floquet theory. And I'll tell you how this is related to the Bloch's theorem. Okay. Now the Bloch's theorem tells you that if there is a Hamiltonian which is periodic in real space, right, then the eigenfunction has to have a modulated plane wave form. Okay, where the eigenfunction has to have a form which is a plane wave in real space multiplied by a function which is again in real space. But the flow key theory is about a periodically driven system. So let me first emphasize in general what we are talking about. Remember, when we talk about Bloch's theorem, then we are talking about equilibrium. We are talking about time independent quantum mechanics. Okay. And we are talking about stationary states or eigenstates. Okay. Now we will consider a completely different system, in the sense that the system, let it be in non-equilibrium, which means that the Hamiltonian is actually an explicit function of time. Okay. Now, how can it be? For example, I'll give you a simple example. So time independent, and I drive it using some function, something like this. Okay. I could have, for example, a bias, okay, a quantum dot, which is connected to two leads, and to this I attach a V, which is basically V naught cos omega t. So it's an AC driven quantum dot, for example. Okay. So this is a system which is inherently out of equilibrium. And if this is an out of equilibrium system, the thing is, out of equilibrium systems are very general, but this kind of a periodic driving can give you certain simplifications, okay, in terms of theory. And what is the similarity between the Bloch's theorem and the flow case theory? Okay, so let me come to that. Here we are talking about periodicity in time. And in Bloch's theorem, we were talking about periodicity in real space. Okay, so I hope you start seeing the similarity now, that if you had a Hamiltonian which is periodic in real space, then the eigenfunction will have a form which looks like a plane wave multiplied with a function which is periodic in real space. Okay, it turns out that if a Hamiltonian is periodic in time, again a similar ansatz can be made. Okay, an ansatz means a guess for the form of the wave function can be made. Okay, so let me write down what that is. I will not go into the proof of this this theorem, but essentially the Bloch flow k, the two things can be now combined. Okay, and what we can do is we can write down a Bloch flow k theorem, which is the following. Suppose I have a Hamiltonian which is periodic with respect to the lattice vectors, but also periodic in time. Okay, so you see, this is the periodicity in time, right? And if we do a translation with respect to this time period, or a translation in real space with respect to the real space lattice vectors, then we get back the same Hamiltonian. Okay, so this is H, X, comma T, right? So the Bloch flow key theorem tells you that if you have a Hamiltonian which is periodic in real space as well as periodic in time, then you can write down the eigenfunctions and they will have a specific form, x comma t, and this will be e to the power I k dot x. This is what we get in the usual Bloch's theorem, but there is a second piece which comes out, which is this. Okay, and let me tell you what these are. Okay, so if this was a time independent system, then we would have just got e to the power I k dot x times u alpha k. That's it, which is what we got in the usual Bloch's theorem, right? But if you had a time periodic system, then you get these things called quasi energies. Okay, now let me bring out one more parallel. If you had periodicity in real space and you have a periodic potential, then you have band theory. What does it mean? You get Ek versus K. Okay, this is called band structure, which means you get electronic bands, but these electronic bands are in K space, the reciprocal space of the real space. Okay, Here also, it turns out that if the Hamiltonian is periodic in time, then what is the Fourier conjugate of that? It's the frequency. So you actually get quasi energies, or you get bands in frequency space. Okay, so these are called Floquet bands. And let me tell you why these things are very important. So let us say that I want to study a particular system, and I want to look at its response to electromagnetic waves. Okay, so then what I can do is that I can consider a system, and then there is a light shining on it, right? But then how does this light couple to this system? It will have certain electric field and a magnetic field. And remember, in an electromagnetic wave, the electric field and the magnetic field are periodic functions of time. Okay, so when they arrive at a certain point, they are periodic functions of time, right? If it's a completely monochromatic wave. So because it's a completely periodic function, you can apply the Floquet theorem. Okay, and because you're considering a crystal, you can apply the Bloch's theorem, right? So if I want to study the response of a system to electromagnetic waves, I can use the Bloch-Floquet theorem. Okay, in a similar way that if I had a periodic potential, I can use the Bloch's theorem. Okay, so does this similarity make sense to you? Is there anyone who has not understood what I'm trying to say?
Sir, can this Bloch-Floquet theorem be used for time crystals?
Well, yeah. So the time crystals actually violate this in some sense, because what happens is that, see, in usual periodic systems, you will get harmonics. You will get a response of the system, which is basically the harmonics of the basic frequency that you have applied. Okay. In time crystals, it turns out that you get subharmonic response. And that is what breaks the periodicity. That's what breaks the time translation invariance with respect to that time period. Okay. So in that sense, there is something special going on in a time crystal. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah. See, in fact, it turned out that this guy, Frank Wilczek, okay, he was the guy. Just one minute, please. Hello. Okay, class meeting there. It's okay. I'll just one nimsha. Yeah. Give me a moment, please. Okay, sorry for the disturbance. Is there any question?
No? Sir, you are going to say something about Wilczek.
Oh, yeah, yeah. So Frank Wilczek, when he proposed this time crystals first, he ideally thought of isolated quantum systems, which were not driven. Okay, see, what I am talking about here is a periodically driven system, because you are applying an external perturbation on the system, which is driving the system according to a certain frequency, which you have imposed from outside, right? So in that sense, a periodically driven system cannot be a closed quantum system. It has to be an open quantum system, okay? But Frank Wilczek had originally envisaged a time crystal to be a isolated quantum system, in the same way that the Bloch's theorem envisages a ideal crystal, which is completely isolated. Okay, if you had an isolated periodic quantum system, periodic in real space, then the Bloch's theorem applies. Okay, and you get a real space crystal. In the same way, Frank Wilczek had also envisaged the same thing. Okay, then what happened was, it was shown by some other people that a closed quantum system can never show time crystal behavior. you have to have an external driving. Okay, and then I mean, there is still a debate going on. In fact, that's a very important question, that whether time crystals can exist as isolated quantum systems, and there are still people who are trying to establish that. Okay, but it turns out that these time crystals, there's so much research going on now that apparently they are probably going to be useful for quantum computation as well. Okay, so there are people who are discussing interaction of time crystals and so on. So yeah, I mean, those of you who have not heard of time crystals, please go back and look it up. It's a very, very interesting concept. Okay, but yes, the original idea of Frank Wilczek was not in line with the Floquet theory. Okay, he envisaged a closed quantum system, whereas what we are talking about is a periodically driven system, which is inherently open because it is being driven from outside. Is that clear?
Okay, sir.
Any other question?
How do we determine the quasi energies?
How do we determine? Okay. So it turns out there is a particular procedure that you can follow. So I was not going into the details, but now that you have asked it, let me come to that. Okay. So what we are saying here is that the if the Hamiltonian is periodic in time and in space, then the eigenfunctions have a certain form. Not the eigenfunctions, the solutions of the time-dependent Schrodinger's equation. Let me tell you how these are determined. U alpha k of x comma t. Okay. So it turns out that this U alpha k, let me first tell you the properties of this. U alpha k of x comma t is the periodic part. This is, remember, just the plane wave. Okay, this is the plane wave and this is the modulation. So now you can see there is modulation both in real space and time. Okay, and the plane wave is the usual plane wave, which is e to the power ik dot x. This is the space part and this is the time part. Okay, so this is x plus ai t plus capital T. Okay. Now it turns out that the original wave, the wave functions that we had in time independent case, suppose I give you this, okay, then what is the space to which they belong? Can you tell me? What is the space to which these real space wave functions belong to?
The Hilbert
space. Hilbert. Yes. Yeah. So Hilbert space is basically a space of functions which are square integrable. Right, which are, when you square them, they can be normalized, right? So they are bounded, they are compact, and many other properties belong to them, right? So the psi of r belong to a certain Hilbert space. Okay, but now it turns out that the u alpha k, because they are both time and space dependent, they belong to a different space, and that space is called the Sambe space. Okay. And this Sambe space is basically the direct product of the usual Hilbert space and a different space. And this T space is basically the space of time periodic functions. Okay. So remember, the Hilbert space is the usual space of square integrable functions, whereas the T space is the space of all time periodic functions. But it's not any general time period. Okay, it's the same time period that we had that the system is being driven with. Okay, and then it turns out that the h of k comma t. Okay, if I take this, this is the Hamiltonian, and if I operate on this, okay, then I get this as energies. So basically, what we are saying, is that the u alpha k's, right, are the eigenfunctions of the time dependent Hamiltonian. So remember, the Bloch Floquet theorem is useful because ideally you would have to solve a full time dependent Schrodinger's equation. Okay, but in time independent quantum mechanics, we are used to solving the eigenvalue equations because we solve h psi equal to e psi. Okay, so if I tell you what is the h of k comma t, right, if I give you that Hamiltonian and you find the eigenvalues of that, those are basically the quasi energies. Okay, so that is the procedure. But what exactly is the h of k comma t? That is what you will ask, Okay, so this Hamiltonian k comma t is given by e to the power minus I k dot x times the original Hamiltonian, which was time independent, minus I del t. So you see what is happening here. The original Schrodinger's equation is basically given by I del t is equal to h, I del t psi equal to h psi, right? And if I take this h minus I del t operating on psi equal to 0, that is the operator that you see here. Okay, and this, if you simplify, you will just get hk of t minus I del t, right? So it turns out that finding the quasi energies is not a very easy problem, and you have to use things called Magnus expansion or a high frequency expansion and things like that. Okay, and using these techniques, you can find these quasi energies. But if you are able to find these quasi energies, then you have essentially solved the problem of a periodically driven system of single particles. Okay, so that's the essential idea. Okay, so if you want to know more details, then I would suggest you can contact a person in my group. His name is Aniruddha, and his MS thesis was on the Floquet theory. Okay, so any other doubts?
This Hamiltonian was time independent or dependent, because we have given t as a parameter.
Oh, no. So this Hamiltonian is time dependent, because we are saying that the original Hamiltonian has some time independent piece, okay, but it also has a time dependent part which is periodic in time. So the Hamiltonian could have a periodic potential in real space. It could also have a periodic time driven part. You understand? Okay, so it has an explicit time dependence.
Okay.
And the original problem of the full time dependent Schrodinger's equation has been simplified to an eigenvalue problem. That is basically the idea. But this eigenvalue problem is just a misnomer, because you have to find the eigenvalues of a differential operator. Okay, and again, eigenvalues of a differential operator are not easy to find. Okay, so you have to use these things called Magnus expansion and high frequency expansion and so on, which gives you certain approximate results for the quasi energies. Okay, but I forgot to mention the interesting part. Using these quasi energies, which is the epsilon alpha case, you get something called Floquet band theory. Okay, so this Floquet band theory is interesting, because remember, when we do real space band structure, we can classify things according to their bands in terms of metals, insulators, semiconductors, and so on. Okay, and when there are things like band crossings, okay, there is a band inversion, then you can get topological effects. Similarly, here it turns out that in Floquet band theory, you can look at the band inversion, you can look at topological properties. So using periodic driving, people have been able to convert trivial insulators into topological insulators. Okay, so that's the interesting part, right? So how do you make something topological when it was non-topological to begin with? Okay, and using this periodic driving and using this understanding that with the Floquet band theory, one can understand this transition or this crossover from trivial insulators to topological insulators. But remember, these topological insulators are not topological insulators in real space or in K-space. They are actually Floquet topological insulators, which means they are dynamical. That means as long as the periodic driving is alive, you are going on driving the system periodically, the system remains topological. If you turn it off, the system becomes trivial. So you can drive this topological to non-topological as you wish, okay? There is a catch in that. I have not talked about that. This is all true for the steady state. This is not true for the transients. So you have to wait until the system reaches steady state, and only then all of this theory is valid. Okay, this is not valid in the transients. Okay, so that was only for those of you who understand. This was not for, not everybody needs to understand what I was saying. But any other doubts?
Sir, I have
yes.
question. Yeah, why are these energies called quasi energies?
Yeah, because you see, these are not stationary states. See, remember, we are trying to solve. Okay, let me tell you this. Suppose I had a Hamiltonian, okay, which is p squared by 2m plus half m omega squared x squared. Right? Now, in this Hamiltonian, there is no time, correct?
Yeah.
So, if I solve this h psi equal to e psi, then I get e is equal to n plus half h cross omega. And I call these as energies, not as quasi-energies. Okay? The reason I call this is because if I place a particle in a certain state, let's say I place this particle in the ground state, okay, psi 1. Then what I get is e to the power minus x squared by psi squared, right? N equal to 0, sorry. It's just a Gaussian, correct? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So, and the ground state energy is just half h cross omega. Now, there is nothing time independent in this, which means once you place the particle in this state, it remains in that state. Okay. But now, this is for the harmonic oscillator and completely time independent. Now, let's consider a periodically driven system. Okay. So, in this case, what we are saying is the Hamiltonian has some piece which looks like this. A cos omega t. So if I plot the Hamiltonian as a function of time, then it has some behavior which looks like this. So the Hamiltonian itself is a strong function of time. Do you see that? Okay. And if that is true, then we are not talking about a problem which looks like this. This is not what we are talking about. If this was the case, then the E would be a stationary state and E would be an energy instead of a quasi-energy. Okay. Here what is happening is because the Hamiltonian is periodic in time, it develops a band structure in frequency space. Remember that if the Hamiltonian is periodic in real space with a periodic potential, it develops a band structure in momentum space, but those bands are stationary bands. They are stationary states. They are not time dependent, and that's why they are called energies. But in this case, the system is fully time dependent, very strongly time dependent. Remember, these frequencies are of the order of terahertz or more. So every second, there are like 10 to the power 12 oscillations. Okay, very strongly time dependent. So in that sense, the energies that you are getting are quasi-energies because you can define these band structures in frequency space. Okay, and they are not the eigenfunctions of some time-independent system. They are actually the eigenenergies of a absolutely time-periodic system. Okay, a driven system which is strongly time-dependent. So that's why they are called quasi-energies. Okay, they are not stationary states like the time independent case that we talked about.
Okay, sir.
Yeah.
Sir?
Yeah.
Sir, here we study about the dynamical system, but if we apply any AC electric field, then we will study this. But in case of electromagnetic wave, it is also an AC electric field. So when electromagnetic wave interact with materials, so why we don't use the Floquet-Bloch band structure? We simply use the normal band structure and we say that this goes to excited state and this goes to
So usually what happens is we treat systems at various levels. Okay, the theory can be done at various levels. One is you can do the theory at a fully quantum level. Okay, and this is what the Bloch-Floquet theorem tries to do. Second thing is that most often what happens is when you shine electromagnetic waves, then these electromagnetic waves do not penetrate into the bulk of the system, especially if the system is a metal. Okay, so you are considering only surface effects. Now, most often what we do is we treat the system as if the electromagnetic wave was a classical entity and only the charge of the electron or the electrons inside the system coupled to that electric field in phase, okay? Which means that the electric field or the electrons are responding to the external electromagnetic waves with the same frequency as was imposed on them, okay? You can get out of phase responses as well. In fact, when we look at the dielectric response of a system, we will see that there will be an in phase response and there will be an out of phase response also, okay? and that will be considered a lossy response. But the essential answer to your question is that there are various levels at which theory can be done. You can do a fully quantum mechanical theory where the electromagnetic wave is also considered as a field, okay, and that field couples to the electron field, and then you can write a fully field theoretic formulation of the entire problem. Okay, the other way to do this is to say that I will consider only the electromagnetic field as a additional term in the Hamiltonian, and this additional term in the Hamiltonian couples only to the charge, and I will not consider the electromagnetic field as a field. Okay, it will be considered as a driving term, so to say. Okay, there is no spatial dependence to that. Remember, an electromagnetic field also has a spatial dependence. Okay, but in this case, you can see that I have written only an A cos omega t, where the A is not not space dependent. In that sense, I am considering long wavelength or a sample which is small enough compared to the wavelength of the electromagnetic wave. Okay, so do you see the various levels of theory that we can do? Shovik?
Sir, what did you say?
So I'm saying there are various levels at which you can do theory. You can use classical electromagnetic theory coupled with single particle quantum mechanics. And this is what we will do when we look at the optical properties of solids. However, you can also do a quantum mechanical treatment of this electromagnetic wave, but at the long wavelength limit, which is what we are doing here. The A here is not space dependent. See, the electromagnetic wave is given by e to the power I k dot r minus omega t, right? So there is also a space dependent part to the electromagnetic waves, but we have not considered that here. We have said that the A is space independent, which means we are saying that at all parts of the sample, the same intensity is falling. It's only time dependent and not space dependent. We can only say that if the sample is small enough compared to the wavelength of light. Okay, so it's only true for very small systems like quantum dots and things like that. Okay, so there are various levels at which theory can be done, and this particular level of theory is again not a completely exact state of the art theory, but it works well in many limits. That's the answer to your question.
Okay, sir, I understood.
Yeah. Any other question?
Sir.
Yeah.
Can we use this concept of Floquet analysis on like coherent vibrational features, like coherent phonons? Is there any
coherent phonons? I'm not sure. See, the thing is, coherent phonons. When you say coherent phonons, can you just explain what you mean? You mean
the response of the material of an ultraviolet.
Okay. So you are saying that like coherent photon emission, there could also be coherent phonon emission, right? Is that what you mean? Hello? Was that Prasad?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So Prasad, coherent phonons, do you mean again the spontaneous phonon emission?
Sir.
Sorry, I think.
Sir, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you, but I think your voice was getting obstructed. Yeah, tell me.
So, meaning when we hit a ultra-pass laser pulse on a material, we see the response of the material by exciting the particular frequency phonon in a very short time with high density.
Okay.
I saw the time dependence of phonon states also now, as we are discussing in analogy with that.
So you are saying,
is there any possibility to?
Now I understand your question now. So you are saying in ultra fast femtosecond spectroscopy, there is this coherent phonon emission, right?
Yes.
And to that, can we apply the block Floquet theory? Correct?
Yeah, I'm just, yes. Yeah. Is there a possibility I'm trying to?
The short answer to your question is no, because in applying flow key theory, one is assuming a steady state. So essentially what I'm saying is, remember when we say h of t is h naught plus a cos omega t, if we are saying that, then there is no origin in time. We are saying that since for t equal to minus infinity to t equal to plus infinity, the Hamiltonian is this. Okay, so it's not that we have started this from some, let's say e to the power minus, it was, let's say theta of t. Okay, it's not that we have started the system at some particular time t, right? Whereas in an ultrafast, this femtosecond spectroscopy, you're basically shining a probe pulse and a pump pulse, right? And so you're talking about a pulse which is, you know, femtoseconds width in time.
It's so, not a steady state.
It's actually very strongly non-equilibrium.
Yeah.
Right. You are pushing the system out of equilibrium for a very, very short time, then sending a probe pulse to record the response of the system in real time. Okay.
Okay.
So it's a very strongly non-equilibrium system, whereas Floquet's theorem assumes that you have reached the steady state, and in the steady state, this would be the response of the system. Okay, so the short answer to this would be that the Floquet theory cannot be applied to femtosecond spectroscopy.
Thank you.
Yeah. Any other question? But do look this up. I mean, I encourage all of you to look this up, because the Floquet bands, topological Floquet insulators, these are all very topics at the very forefront. And a lot of work is going on this block Floquet theory. Okay. So, and I wanted to point out that as you can have systems which are periodic in space, you can also have driving, which is periodic in time. And essentially, like the Bloch's theorem, you can have a Floquet's theorem, right? And you get wave functions which look very similar again to what we get in the Bloch's theorem. Okay. So that brings both time and space on an equal footing. Okay, so with that digression, let's go back to the Bloch's theorem, the usual time independent case. Okay, so now for those of you who did not get interested in this digression, let's come back to the time independent case of the Bloch's theorem. So forget Floquet theory for now. Okay, now I want to make a few points. First of all, h cross k, okay, is a momentum, sure. If you find the units of this, it's actually a momentum. But I made this point earlier also, but it's not the electron's momentum. So what do we mean by this? Okay. So the meaning of this is, let's take electrons in free space. If I take electrons in free space, then let me talk to Suhas online.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay. So Suhas, in free space, what would be the wave function of electrons? Sorry?
AFR is equal to.
What would be the wave function? E to the power?
IK.
Very good. So it's e to the power ik dot r, right? Now, if I apply the momentum operator on this, okay? So I apply the momentum operator on this, what do I get?
I h cross.
Okay. So p hat is what?
I h cross.
is I h cross or is it minus I h
cross? Minus I h cross.
Yeah. So I can write this as h cross by I times L.
Yeah. So.
What do I get?
So k, h cross k.
Correct.
By I.
H cross k by I. Will we get h cross k by I?
The I will be cancelled.
Correct.
I will be
cancelled. Back the e to the power ik dot r, right?
For ik dot r, yeah.
Very good. So which means that the psi k of r is an eigenfunction of the momentum operator with the eigenvalue h cross k. Correct?
Yes.
So which means if the electron is in a particular state, e to the power I k dot r, then it has a certain momentum h cross k. Okay.
Yeah.
Now let's go back to inside the crystal. Okay. And now you tell me, what should I write here in the first line? So I want to do exactly parallel calculation for electrons inside the crystal. So what should I write here? What should be the psi k of r?
E power IKR.
Okay.
Into UKR.
UKFR, correct. Okay. And now if I apply the momentum operator, what do I get?
Okay.
Sorry?
Now, this will be like UKFR also position dependent. So,
correct.
H cross K.
Yes. H cross k will be the same, and we will get back the psi k of r.
Yeah, psi k.
But there will be an additional term.
Yeah, plus uk dash something.
Correct. So it will be basically e to the power I k dot r, and then okay. H cross k l will act on the uk of r.
Yeah.
Correct.
Yeah.
Very good. Okay. Yeah, you can mute yourself. Right.
Thank
so
you.
Essentially, what we are seeing is that there is an additional term here, which is spoiling that eigenvalue equation for the momentum. Okay, so the h cross k is not the eigenvalue of the momentum operator anymore. In that sense, the h cross k is definitely a momentum, but it is not the electron's momentum. Okay, and the h cross k is called the crystal momentum. And the other way to understand this is that the h cross k determines, or the h cross k is actually a quantum number. The k is a quantum number that characterizes the electron wave function inside the crystal. Okay. In the same way that for an hydrogen atom, the N, L, M, and S, okay, these are the quantum numbers of the wave functions when subjected to a central potential like the hydrogen atom, right? In the same way, the K and the spin, these are the quantum numbers for electrons inside the crystal. And the wave function for these electrons inside the crystal looks like a plane wave, but not a plane wave. Okay, it's a modulated plane wave, right? But one thing is that there is a one-to-one correspondence between the free space wave functions and the crystal wave functions. Okay, in fact, it's not exactly a one-to-one correspondence. Can somebody tell me whether this one-to-one correspondence is correct or so I will tell you the answer. There is no one-to-one correspondence between the free space wave functions and the crystal wave functions. Can somebody tell me the reason why? So in other words, what we are saying is that the wave function here is e to the power I k dot r, okay? And the wave function here is also e to the power I k dot r uk of r. But in deriving this, I have actually neglected one small thing, and that can somebody point out that this is actually a one to many mapping. It's not a one to one mapping.
Sir,
it's a
Brillouin.
Yes.
Sir, Brillouin can be many. We can shift the k vector by 2 pi by a, or it is minus pi by a to plus pi by a, but when it is beyond that, we can add a vector and keep it to the Brillouin. So effectively, for a particular for a many k, we can have a same wave function. So that means we can change it to the Brillouin, and we can indicate this as different wave function.
Not exactly that. So you are saying that there is some kind of a periodicity in reciprocal space also, okay? And that periodicity in the reciprocal space gives you a one-to-many mapping, but that's not essentially right, because if I take this wave function inside the crystal and do a reciprocal space translation, then if it remains the same, then it is exactly the same wave function. Okay, so let me tell you the answer. Okay, the question was not posed properly, so let me tell you the answer. What I have not written here is another index, which is the n index, and that's called the band index. Sorry,
I was saying that is the band index.
Correct. Yeah, so see, what we have not shown using this Bloch's theorem or using that equation that we derived for the coefficients that there can be many bands in a system. Okay, and these bands are what tells you that the mapping is actually one to many, because the k and the spin, they both are the same, but there is an extra index corresponding to every k and every spin, that is the band index, and that makes it a one to many mapping. Okay, and many of you would have seen this kind of a spaghetti structure. I mean, there are many talks in JNC, the new students might not have seen it, but you might have seen something like this. Okay, there is a spaghetti structure, right? So if you hear talks by Professor Umesh Vaghmare's group or Professor Shobhna Narasimhan's group or Professor Swapan Pathy's group, then you will see all this kind of energy dispersions. Okay, and you can also look at Kittel and Ashcroft and see how these band structures look like. Okay, so for every k, right, there are multiple energies, and these are all multiple bands. Okay, and we will see how these band structures, how these bands arise in the next topic that we are going to do, which is an exactly solvable model of a 1D periodic system. Okay, and that is called the Kronig-Penney model. Okay, so I've not told you how bands arise. Okay, and the next model, the next topic that we are going to do will tell us how these bands arise. Okay. Any doubts so far?
Sir?
Yeah?
Sir, can you just repeat what the critical momentum represents physically?
I'm sorry?
So what critical momentum represents physically? It is not a momentum of electron, but it is written momentum. So what momentum it indicating?
Okay. So, it's actually it's the wave vector corresponding to that particular Bloch wave function. Okay, let me ask you the following. Okay, so if I take the hydrogen atom, right, and I solve the problem of an electron which is not subjected to the central potential, I will get again a free electron wave function, which is the plane wave. But now if I subject that same electron to a central potential, like in the hydrogen atom, the quantum numbers change from k and spin to n, l, m and the spin. You agree with me?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Now, what is the significance of these quantum numbers n, l, m and s?
Sir, where did the momentum go? So the electron. Electron,
right,
total.
So, yeah, let me just rephrase. What I'm trying to say is that the electron had some momentum when it was in free space. Okay, that was h cross k. Correct?
Yes, sir.
Now, inside hydrogen atom. Sorry?
Sir, it is just a quantum number.
Yeah. Okay. If it is just a quantum number, what we are asking here is that does the electron have any momentum?
Yes.
It has, right?
Yes.
Can you take that momentum and describe it in terms of the n, l, m and s?
So we can find the expectation value over operator.
That's exactly the point. Here also, the k does not have a direct interpretation in terms of the momentum of the electron. Okay. But you can take the momentum operator like we have done here. Okay. And then you can take an expectation value in terms of the Bloch state. Okay, and that defines the expectation value, the momentum operator, right? So this way you can define, but the h cross k should be taken in the same spirit that you take the n, l, m and sigma. Okay, it's a new quantum number.
Yeah.
It's a new quantum number that describes the electronic states inside the crystal. Okay. And we will see the significance. In fact, we will actually use the h cross k as a semi-classical quantum number, Remember, when we derived the block oscillations, we actually took the h cross k itself to be the momentum. Okay, and that is why it was a quasi quantum mechanical or a quasi classical, semi classical calculation, right? So the block oscillations derivation that we did was not purely quantum mechanical, because we assumed that the h cross k itself is the momentum. So in some sense, we had ignored this part. Okay, so but you must view this h cross k as, or k as, the new quantum number that arises when the electrons are subjected to a periodic potential. Is that clear? Okay, so Jaydeep ji, class mein hoon. Right.
Sir.
Yeah.
Why is the block wave function not an eigenfunction of momentum operator? Is it because the symmetry here is discrete symmetry and the...
Yes. If it had been an eigenfunction of the pure momentum operator, then the translational symmetry would have been a continuous translation symmetry.
Yes. Okay.
Right?
Yeah. Yes.
Because it is discrete now, it's not an eigenfunction of the momentum operator. Right? Okay. And then... let's talk about the E case. Okay. I'm writing them as ENK and not as EK. And we will come to why these band indices arise. But let's take these EN case. And these we know are eigenvalues of a real and symmetric matrix. How do we say that? It's because... remember, these E and K's were basically solutions of this equation, minus E times C K minus capital K plus sum over K dash U of K dash minus K. Now, this is actually a real symmetric matrix. Or at the most, it's a complex Hermitian matrix, and the eigenvalues of that are real, right? Not only real, they are actually bounded. Okay? These eigenvalues are real and bounded. Okay. Now this has a strong implication. The implication is that in the Brillouin zone, right? If you take the entire Brillouin zone, the ENKs will have some maximum and some minimum, which is finite. A finite maximum and a finite minimum, which is basically saying that they don't fly off to infinity or minus infinity. Okay. And that tells you that somewhere in the Brillouin zone, this ENK is going to have a minimum, and somewhere in the Brillouin zone, it's going to have a maximum. This is K space, by the way. This is KX, KY, and KZ. So in that sense, if I look at the energy structure in K space, then the band corresponding to this index n is going to have a band width, okay, a finite band width. And the band width will be defined as ENK maximum minus ENK minimum. Okay, so every band in the Brillouin zone will have a certain finite bandwidth, which is given by the maximum of the ENK within the Brillouin zone minus the minimum of the ENK within the Brillouin zone. And this bandwidth is guaranteed to be finite because the eigenvalue equation that we are solving, the system of linear equations that we are solving, are at the most complex and Hermitian. Okay, so we are guaranteed real and bounded solutions. Okay, so this is another statement about the energies. Then one last statement is the following. We can define something called, something like a velocity here, which is the following: del k of ENK. And Shovik, this is going to be important for your question. Okay. So what we have done here is that we have taken the dispersion En of k, and we have taken the gradient of that, and then done a 1 by h cross. Okay, so this is a kind of a velocity, right? So now here it can be shown that this is actually equal to 1 over m integral dr psi n k star h cross by I gradient psi n k. Okay, so Shovik, can you tell me what is the right hand side? What is the significance
of expectation of momentum by mass?
Exactly. So it's the expectation value of the momentum operator. And the expectation value is with respect to the block states. Correct? And that turns out to be related to the gradient in K space. See, remember here, this is a gradient in real space, right? Okay. It turns out to be related, or it's equal to the gradient in K space of the dispersion. Okay. So when we draw a certain band structure, right, and we take the slope there, that defines a kind of a velocity. Okay. And this velocity turns out to be the same as the expectation value of the momentum operator for the block state. Okay. So, and it turns out that this velocity is also non-vanishing. Okay, it's a finite velocity. And this has a significance. So remember, in classical Drude model, if marbles are traveling through a periodic system, they will definitely scatter. Okay, classical marbles will definitely scatter when traveling through a periodic classical lattice. However, in the quantum mechanical case, if electrons are traveling through a periodic potential, they have a finite time independent velocity. Okay. And notice here, we have not applied any electric field. Okay. This is in the absence of any electric field. What we are saying is every block state corresponds to having a finite velocity, which means electrons in that state, if that state is occupied, then the electrons will have a finite velocity, which is non-vanishing, and hence they are moving without scattering. Okay, so this is the essence of the Bloch's theorem, that you're taking these Bloch states and taking the expectation value of the momentum operator and defining a certain velocity. And this velocity being non-zero is telling you that the electron motion inside a periodic potential is completely coherent which means it doesn't scatter at all. Okay, no scattering, and it's as if the electrons were in free space. Okay, it's equivalent to that because there is absolutely no scattering. So this is equivalent to ballistic motion. Okay. And this entire thing is possible only because the electrons have a wave-like nature. And what I would also like to emphasize here is that the entire band theory relies on the quantum mechanical nature of electrons. Okay. And here I want to make a slightly philosophical statement. Most people, when you hear them talking about quantum mechanics, they might argue that quantum mechanics is applicable only at very low temperatures, it's applicable only to extremely tiny systems, and so on. Okay, but I don't agree with that. And the basic idea is, let us take a metal. Okay, the fact that a metal conducts, or let's take more importantly a semiconductor. Okay, and there is absolutely no way you can explain a semiconductor or the behavior of a semiconductor using classical mechanics. Right, the entire concept of a band gap, of conduction bands and valence bands, relies on having a band theory. And band theory is what is essential to band theory is the wave-like nature of electrons. Okay, or in other words, what we are talking about is the solution of the Schrodinger's equation, not the Newton's laws, to understand the periodic potential or the motion of electrons in a periodic potential. So all of semiconductor physics relies on quantum mechanics. And we are talking about, you know, computers, mobiles, and all of these things which operate at room temperature and above, right? And quantum mechanics is actually operating at these scales, these length scales, and these temperature scales. So quantum mechanics is not restricted only to the nano and to the lowest temperature regime. It's there all around us. Okay. And whenever you think of a semiconductor, you have to think of it as quantum mechanical. You cannot divorce quantum mechanics from semiconductor physics, right? In fact, it's more general. If you think about chemical bonding, okay, all of covalent bonding is purely quantum mechanical. So the concept of bonding itself involves a lowering of the energy due to a quantum mechanical exchange, right? And you just cannot explain chemical bonding without using quantum mechanics. So, you know, water, for example, is a quantum mechanical object. Okay. The fact that you can get H2O is quantum mechanical. And you can have water at room temperature, right? You can have water molecules even at 100 degrees Celsius. Okay. So water molecule is a quantum mechanical object, and quantum mechanics is operating at very high temperatures. Okay. Anyway, this was a digression. Those of you who want to debate with me, please welcome. When you are here, let's sit and talk about it. Okay, but that's my opinion. Any questions on this?
I could not understand, like, how we are saying that the electron is not being scattered.
Oh, you could not understand that. Sure. Go on.
So how we are associating that gradient of energy with the momentum?
How we are doing that? Okay, that's a different issue. I have not shown this. We will come back to this at some point. I am just stating this. Okay, so take this as a theorem. This equality, I have not proved it. Okay, and if you are eager to know the proof, then this has been proved in, in the appendix E of Ashcroft and Merman. Okay, it's proved there, but actually when we consider the conductivity of filled bands versus partially filled bands, we will come to this equality. So that is the equality part. Second thing is, why are we saying that the electron motion is coherent, or it is it's not scattering at all? So what we are showing here is that the expectation value of the momentum operator with respect to a block state is finite and non-vanishing and time independent. Okay, so if the electron is or if that particular block state is occupied, then the momentum has a finite expectation value. In that sense, we are saying that the electron is moving with a certain velocity, or the electron wave is moving with a certain velocity, it's propagating with a certain velocity, and that velocity is constant. So in that sense, it's exactly what you would get in free space also. Okay, see, in free space, if you calculate these two quantities, you would get h cross k by m. You agree?
Yeah.
So this would be the vk. And because this is independent of time and constant, we say that the electron does not suffer any scattering in real space, in free space. Okay. But inside a periodic crystal, we are getting exactly the same result. We are finding that the vnk is finite. Of course, it depends on k, as it depends in free space on k also, but it also depends on the band index. Okay, and in crystals, the en of k can be a very, very complicated function of k, right? And so the vnk is not going to be linearly proportional to k. That is for sure. Okay, but it is true that it is time independent, and it is finite and non-vanishing, which is why we are saying that electrons are not scattering when moving through a periodic potential inside a crystal. Is that equivalence clear?
We are saying that it is finite because energy is finite.
The E of k is finite, correct. The E of k is not only finite, remember we are taking a gradient. So if you are taking a gradient, then the slope is also finite. See, the En of k should not have a form which looks like this, for example. If you have a form like this, then the En of k will diverge. Is it not? The slope will be infinite. Okay, so yeah, it is continuous and the slope is well defined everywhere, right? So there are many properties associated with the En of k. It's not only real and bounded, it's also smooth. It is even the first derivative is well defined and continuous everywhere, and so on. Okay, in fact, if you take the second derivative, you will arrive at the effective mass. Okay, and even the effective mass has to be finite and well defined everywhere. So these En of k's are actually analytic functions. Okay.
Okay. Yeah. And in the same way, we are not saying that V and K is constant throughout the band.
No, no, it's actually band dependent. Yes. It's K dependent, yeah. It's band dependent. Absolutely. See, in free space also, V is actually K dependent. If you take different values of K, you will get different Vs. Here also, if you take different K values, you will get different Vs. Exactly same. Right? So in K space, the V depends on where you are. Here also, in free space also. Okay?
Yeah.
All right. So these were the general properties of block wave functions and eigenfunctions and so on. Now, before we solve that same eigenvalue equation that we derived, what we would like to do is to solve a particular model. Okay? And this particular model is called the Kronig-Penney model. And the usefulness of this model is that it is an exactly solvable model. It is an exactly solvable model. And anytime you come across an exactly solvable model, it becomes extremely useful for that field, okay? For many reasons, okay? So if you had an exactly solvable model, then you can go into the depths of that model and figure out why something is happening. Okay, so you see a certain phenomenon like the formation of bands. Then you can analyze this model to any extent and figure out why bands are forming. Okay, so having an exactly solvable model helps a lot. Okay, and the general theory of exactly solvable models is called integrable models. And having integrable models in any field becomes extremely useful. For example, in magnetism, a 1D Ising model, for those of you who are familiar, 1D Ising model and the 2D Ising model, classical, these are exactly solvable. Okay. And if you take the quantum mechanical case, then the 1D transverse field Ising model is exactly solvable. And it turns out that this transverse field Ising model can be mapped onto a different model called the Kitaev chain. And this I am telling you because the Kitaev chain hosts some new kind of particles called the Majorana particles. And a lot of research is currently going on this particular system called the Kitaev chain, which is actually a one-dimensional topological superconductor. So we start from a transverse field Ising model, which is the model of spins interacting with each other, but it can be mapped on to a one-dimensional topological superconductor. And this 1D topological superconductor hosts something called Majorana particles. And these Majorana particles are supposed to be very important for quantum computation. Okay, so what I'm trying to say here is that if you want to get an exactly solvable model of qubits, okay, then you take the Kitaev chain. You will be able to get an exact model of the qubits, right? So it helps researchers in the field to understand, for example, if I drive the system, what will happen? If I introduce noise into the system, what will happen? Okay? Things like that, yeah. Yes?
Can I start the food?
Any question?
Can I?
Okay. Somebody has unmuted. With some background noise. Okay. Yeah, so the Kronig-Penney model also turns out to be very useful in this sense, because it can be solved exactly. We can get all the eigenfunctions and eigenvalues exactly. And because of that, we can derive the band structure and we can see how these bands are forming. And you can take variations of this and then do more calculations. Okay. So what is the Kronig-Penney model? It's again a one-dimensional model. And we replace the periodic potential with a very simple form of the periodic potential. Okay. And it's actually called a piecewise periodic potential. Piecewise constant periodic potential. So let me tell you how that looks like. Okay. So it looks something like this. And then like this. And so on. So it's periodic, but the period is not exactly A. Let me tell you what that is. This is again A plus B. This would be again A. So this would be 2A plus B. This would be 2A plus 2B, and so on. Okay. So you can see here that this entire thing is the period. Okay, or A plus B is the period, right? So the lattice parameter is A plus B in this 1D system, okay? And let me just show you what is this an idealization of. So I'll open Kittel here. This is Kittel. And see, real crystals could have potentials which look like this. This is the ion core, right? And exactly where the ion core is placed, because it is positively charged, it would form a trap for the electron. Okay, so there is a large negative potential here. But if you go far from the ion core, then the potential should become zero, right? So this is the actual form of the periodic potential, right? But then what we are idealizing it by is this kind of a model, okay? Where the wells here are replaced by square wells, right? Instead of having a very large depth well, you're cutting it off, and not only cutting it off, you're making it a square well, right? So this is, in some sense, you can think of it as a sequence of barriers, or you can think of it as a sequence of wells, and the ions would be sitting at the centers of these wells. Okay, so that is essentially the Kronig-Penney model. And this model, so you should also think of this as equivalent to the coupled oscillator model of phonons that we could solve exactly in the 1D case. Okay, so here also we are looking at the model of a periodic potential, and this model is a simplified model called the Kronig-Penney model. Okay, any questions? So if I want to write H of R plus A plus B, so this is just X here, it's just 1D, okay, then it is H of X. In more general terms, I can do this. Okay. So if this is true, then I should be able to use the Bloch's theorem. Okay. And I should be able to write, using the Bloch's theorem, a certain ansatz for the wave functions. Okay, so we don't have much time left, but is Purnendu online?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so Purnendu, can you tell me what should I write here for the wave function? What should be the form of the wave function? If this is the, if this is true, if this periodicity is true.
So we can take the Bloch wave function.
Correct. Correct. So what should be the form?
And for one dimension, ukx times e to the power of ikx.
Okay. So e to the power ikx times ukx. And this is the psi k of x. Good. Now this k here belongs to a certain Brillouin zone, right?
Yeah. First Brillouin zone.
Yeah. So what is the total extent of that Brillouin zone?
It's minus pi by a to pi by a.
Okay. Can you correct that? Can you correct this? There is a slight mistake in this. What should come here? See, in a normal 1D lattice, what does A represent? It's the lattice parameter, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
So it's the periodicity of the real space.
Here A plus B.
Ah, correct. So it should be A plus B. So the Brillouin zone here is represented by minus pi over A plus B to pi over A plus B. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Very good. And the UK of X is the periodic part, correct? So yes, the UK of X times N plus N times A plus B should be equal to UK of X.
X.
Okay? And if I do psi k of X plus N times A plus B, right? Then I should get e to the power I k times N times A plus B,
plus B.
Times
psi k of X.
Yeah. Okay? And it's this part that we will be using in solving this this Kronig-Mini model. So, okay, yeah, you can mute yourself. Okay, so the thing is, this there are only 3 minutes remaining now, so let me not go into the full solution of this model, but let me indicate what we are going to do. Okay, and the idea is that let's call this maximum U naught. Okay, and let's say the zero of the potential is here. So if an electron has enough energy, and if the energy is greater than U0, then it is free. It can actually escape the crystal. Okay. So in some sense, you can think of the U0 as like the work function. Okay. But let me not go into that interpretation. Let's say that U0 is the maximum of the potential. So the electron's energy inside the crystal would be somewhere in between the minimum and the maximum, which is U0. Right. So the electron has an energy which is somewhere here. And then if the energy is at this level, when the the wave function here inside this well is going to be of the form of a traveling wave, e to the power ikx plus e to the power minus ikx. But inside this barrier is going to be of the exponential form, e to the power qx plus e to the power minus qx. Okay, cd, ab. And all that we are going to do is that we are going to match the boundary conditions for the wave functions here and here, okay, and the slopes. So we will match the wave functions and we will match the slopes of the wave function, apply periodic boundary conditions and derive certain equations to find out A, B, C, D, okay. And by solving that determinant, we will be able to arrive at conditions relating the K here to the crystal momentum K. Okay, so this is what we will do next time, and what you are going to see is I will also show you a Python program to solve the resulting eigenvalue equation. So it turns out that it is exactly solvable only to the extent that we can get a closed form equation to solve. Okay, but to solve that equation we have to use a little bit of numerics, right? And I will show you a 20 line Python program using which you can get the full band structure of the system. And I will also pass on that Python program to you to play with. You can just change the parameters in the Python program and see how the band structure changes. For example, you can make the depth of these wells very large, right? So if these wells are extremely deep, what happens to the band structure? If the wells are almost equal to each other in width, then what happens, and stuff like that. Okay, or if the well is extremely narrow compared to the free part, then what happens? So all of these things you will be able to play with that. Okay, but tomorrow is the in-house symposium, so we will not be able to meet tomorrow. We will meet on Saturday at 11. Okay,
sir, I have an exam on Saturday.
What time?
10:30 to 11:30.
Can we meet at 11:45?
Okay.
Any other problems? At 11:45 we meet? 11:45 to 1, say, for example. Would that be okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Sir, I have a doubt.
Yeah, sorry.